Hello everyone. Thanks for your participation and attending this webinar. This is Dhaval Sahija, Business Development Manager from Signet Infotech. Signet Infotech is a global software solution and implementation service provider. We provide custom software development services to multiple domains and technologies with clients across 23 plus countries. Signet Infotech holds quality management accreditations like ISO 9001 and CMOI level 3. And we also have accreditations with regards to information security like ISO 27001. We do have partnerships with companies such as Oracle, Microsoft, Sitefinity, Sitecore, Intel, HP, and NobCommerce. To learn more about Signet, kindly visit www.signet-infotech.com. Concerned webinar is sponsored by TestingWiz and M1. TestingWiz is an easy and affordable test automation solution that uses keyword-driven testing and data-driven testing for web and cloud application testing. To know more about TestingWiz, kindly visit www.testing-wiz.com. M1 is an enterprise ordering system that provides a range of smartphone-based ordering apps applicable for B2B retail, restaurants, and catalog companies. To know more about M1, visit www.my-m1.com. The concerned webinar would be hosted by my colleague Nirav and Neil, who are concerned tech leads in Java. I'll pass on the line to Nirav to take it forward.
Hey guys. So we'll be starting with our webinar, and the agenda for today's webinar is why you cannot ignore cross-platform development, what are the key architectural considerations, how you can control cost and schedule with responsive web design, what is the role of String MVC in cross-platform development, what can be the useful tools being a developer and project leader? What are the best practices as a part of do's and don'ts when you are developing cross-platform projects? And finally, we'll be presenting a live demonstration on how we can build a sample cross-platform application. We'll be starting with our first point, that is why you cannot ignore cross-platform development. Nowadays, be it an e-commerce application or a banking application, or be it an informative site such as Wikipedia, or let it be some social media application, or any of the commercial applications you take, it's not only the mobile or the web application, but it is a collection of all applications wherein you can find your users. So in order to promote your applications to multiple persons across continents, you must have applications over web, mobile, tablet, and desktops. Also for your marketing team, when you have a larger fan base, marketing becomes easier in the sense that you don't have to create niche messages to cater to a specific set of people. You have the liberty of marketing the application on various media and to generalize messages for the market. So once a material is created, it can be used across various media. when you are having cross-platform development in consideration, the development time would be reduced drastically, because at times we have seen that generally our clients come up with a requirement wherein the scope for application is to develop only the web application, and as the product moves, they realize that okay, they wanted also to have a mobile application for the same product, and at that point of time, if I consider reframing my code and redesigning my code, it will take me a lot of time in order to do the refragmentation of the code. So if something is clear to me upfront, then I'll be architecting my application in a way that it can be used across platforms, and only it requires is the integration efforts with the various platforms. For example, desktop, web, mobile, and tablet. Also, when it is a cross-platform development, in order to pass the same message from all the applications, the user experience has to be consistent, be it the logo, theme, or the menu style. Everything, it should be common across all the platforms. The testing cycle effort would be reduced because there would be a centralized business logic lying somewhere at one place, and all clients will be accessing the same logic. So essentially, the testers will be spending one-time effort to test the business logic and the scenarios. Otherwise, rest of the things would be pure UI testing. So the testing cycles will be shortened, and the go live for the product would be quicker. The development teams will have an upfront clarity for designing the application. So they would be able to visualize the code resolution part right from the design, and that will help in speed of the development. So all in all, with all these factors, the product development would be faster. And generally, the development team can avoid the temptations. For example, if I'm a developer and if I'm coding something for my web application, I would be tempted to code the validation logic in the view layer. But if I am sure that this application is going to be used by, say, the mobile client, the desktop client, and the web client, so instead of coding the validation logic in my view layer, what I'll be doing is I'll be moving that part of code of validation from the client side to the server side, so that irrespective of any client, I can reuse my code for validation. So this kind of care can be taken right at the design layer, and we can take benefit of that. Let us take a look at what are the possible architectural considerations. So the first approach, if we take, that is a traditional approach, that you write down your project in a way that all your services would be exposed as a RESTful or SOAPful web services, and the client can access these web services from the view layer, that is desktop, mobile, tablet, or web. This particular approach is having an advantage of centralized business logic, which is lying at the server side. The APIs exposed would be common for all of them, so that would be centralized. And since it is one single code, the code maintenance would be far easier. At the same time, it has a downside of multiple UI to be created. So if you are having mobile and tablet edition, you need to have two set of UI to be created. Since there would be two development teams involved for creating UI for mobile and tablet, They need to be extra careful in order to make sure that the branding is consistent in both of the UIs. And once the request is coming to the centralized server logic, the server logic need to pass in order to identify whether the request is coming from, say, the mobile or from tablet. And based on that, they can write down their redirection rules for a particular set of UIs. So this also is a downside for approach one, that is using pure RESTful or SOAPful web services. A slightly tweaked approach to this architectural consideration is approach two, wherein we can go and leverage the benefits of Spring, and we can make use of a plugin called Spring Mobile. And so far view layer is concerned, that would be a normal UI design, that is non-responsive web design. Again, client can access application from tablet, mobile, and web. So the advantages with this application approach is centralized business logic that is lying inside the Spring services, centralized API controlling, again the single code base, and hence it is maintainable as well. In order to identify request source automatically for ease in redirection rules, Spring Mobile plugin will help us out. And if my product owner wants that there should be different set of features to be offered when a person is visiting website from, say, mobile or from tablet or from web, then this different set of features can be offered because there will be separate UI available. And I can write down my UI layer in a way that whatever I want to present, I'll be showcasing only those things. So these are the benefits. And on the other end, since there would be no single UI, you need to code multiple UI for each devices. And since there is multiple UIs involved, you need to be extra careful so that the branding message for marketing remains consistent. An alternate to the same approach with a slight tweak is again using Spring for the backend or server-side logic, use of Spring Mobile plugin for identification of the request source, and especially on the view layer, we can go with responsive web design. The client can access application from tablet, mobile, and web as usual. The advantages of this particular approach would be centralized business logic, centralized API controlling, maintainable code. The source for request can be automatically identified, and based on that, we can code our redirection rules. These four would be same as the earlier approach. The addition benefit over here in this particular approach of responsive web design would be there will be a single UI created by the graphics team, and based on the request coming in, the UI would be adjusted automatically to fit in the client's screen. And since there is a single UI involved, there would be more chances for consistent branding because there is a single file involved in code layer. So for downside is concerned, since it is a single UI, it would be a bit cumbersome and slightly more effort would be required in order to provide different set of features. In a sense, say for example, you want to provide 5 features if a person is visiting the web from, say, mobile, and you want to provide the full-fledged application which consists of, say, 10 features if the person is surfing the web from his laptop. So in order to do this kind of thing, you need to write down a lot of conditional code, and that would be a bit cumbersome if you are writing the single UI. So for performance is concerned, since a single file with the help of layered CSS rendering the page, the performance would be slightly degraded, and of course the time required to code the view layer would be more, because the graphic designer needs to take care of multiple resolutions and multiple viewports. So these are the cons if we are going with responsive web design. Now for all those who is new to the term responsive web design, responsive web design is a web design and development technique that creates a site or system that reacts to the size of user screen. So that design will optimize users' browsing experience by creating a flexible and responsive web page optimized for the device that is accessing it. So the most important benefit of a responsive design is its adaptability to adjust to different screens, and the website can be viewed easily and accessed on all kinds of devices ranging from say desktop to iPhone with professional neat look. The size of screen, content, images and font are readjusted to give high quality interface for any kind of device. So if I look at graphically the responsive web design, the first image that you can see is the rendering available for the web. The centered one is rendering on tablet, and the last one on right is rendering on the mobile device. So you can see that view layer is automatically adjusted based on the dimension of the client screen. Instead of this block, if we take a look at the real UI, it would look like something this. This is the portion from web, this is from tablet, and this is from the mobile application. So the benefits with responsive web design would be increase in sales and conversion rate, because the UI would be consistent for browsing from mobile, web and tablet. You need to write down your analytics and reporting at a single place, so the consolidated efforts from marketing can drive the traffic. Since there would be a single page available, the visibility as far as SEO content is concerned and the ranking on search engines are concerned, that would be much higher compared to three different sources. And since the code base is available on single view file, it is far easier to manage, and any kind of change that is required can be done very easily. So these are the benefits with responsive web design. What is the role of Spring MVC if you are considering this cross-platform development? With Spring MVC, the inherent feature is clear separation of roles. When we say roles, it is controller, validator, form object, model object, dispatcher servlet, handler mapping, validators, view resolvers, and so on. And each role can be fulfilled by a specialized object. So more you have separation of roles, more you will be having clarity on the code and architecture. And similarly, you will be having a lot of scope for reusing this object. And at the same time, you can maintain all the security aspects that you want to manage. Powerful and straightforward configuration that is on both the framework and application classes as Java build, including easy referencing across contexts such as from web controllers to business objects and validators. that can be easily achievable with the help of Spring MVC. Adaptability and non-intrusiveness, that is, to be used whatever controller support you need. It might be the command, it might be the form wizard, it might be the plain one, it might be multi-action, or it might be a custom coded controller for a given scenario instead of deriving from a single scenario for everything. So this kind of feature is already supported by Spring MVC, and it must be utilized while developing the cross-platform application. The concept of GAN, that is, do not repeat yourself. All the business code can be reusable. You can use existing business objects as command or form objects instead of mirroring them in order to extend a particular framework based class. Can be easily done with the help of Spring MVC. Support for customizable binding and validation. So the type mismatches as application level validation errors that keep the offending value localized based and number binding, etc. instead of string only form objects with manual parsing and conversion to business objects. Customizable handle mapping and view resolution. So handle mapping and view resolution strategies that can range from simple URL based configuration to the more sophisticated purpose-based resolution strategies. This is more flexible than some web MVC framework which mandates a particular technique. More options we have available for Spring MVC, and we can leverage that definitely. And last but not the least is flexible model transfer. There is model transfer via a name value map that is easily supported and integrated with any kind of new technology for your desktop, tablet, mobile, or web. So Spring MVC is a vital feature and can be utilized in coordination with Spring MVC plugin to have a very quick cross-platform development. This also means that if you are having an existing web application coded in Spring MVC, and if you want to extend the support, and if you want to build the application in, say, the mobile device or the tablet device, you can just go ahead and use the Spring mobile plugin, and you can definitely achieve your target. What can be the tools? So far development is concerned, the standard IDE, that is Eclipse, with needful plugin. Of course, you can go with any other IDEs like NetBeans or IDEA, Firebug, web development tools, Android simulators to test UI for the tablet, SOAP UI in case you are going for SOAP full web services. REST client, this can also be the standard plugin for your browser like Chrome, so that you can test out your web services. JUnit, in order to promote page-driven development, so that you can make sure that whatever logic you have written is foolproof. LoadRunner, in order to handle multiple requests for the web services. And of course, the Spring Mobile, which is used to better and know that which request is coming from which target. A few do's and don'ts based on the experience that we are sharing. A lot of times we have seen that the developers are tempted to use the old features of Java. So even though there is a latest feature available as a part of recent Java releases, they tempted to go for the older Java versions and older approaches. So we recommended to go for the best of Java features available. As of now, there is Java 1.8 release candidate already published, but You can very well go with the most stable version, that is 1.7, and you can leverage all the benefits. Whatever APIs we are creating, it should not be vendor dependent. So instead of exposing the classes directly to the client, and the classes are vendor dependent, what you should be doing is, you should be wrapping over the interfaces, and interfaces only should be exposed to the client. So at any given point of time, if something is to be changed, you can go ahead and change the vendor implementation irrespective of any change required at your client. Branding. You need to stick to branding so that the common message is sent across all the devices. Especially when developing mobile applications for existing brands, it is really vital that developers use existing branding resources whenever possible. And no amount of graphical or cross-platform experience design can replace user familiarity. So in a situation where the application is representation of larger entity, you can think of say Wikipedia or CNN as opposed to something like cut the rope. So a surefire way to make the user feel at home is to use things like logos, fonts and colors uniquely wherever possible. As far as web services are concerned, showful web services are more preferred way, especially when dealing with the mobile applications. So you can choose RESTful web implementation of web services over showful. And especially when returning errors to the presentation layer, say for example there is some error when a request arrives to my web services and I want to report back some error. So instead of returning back the error, what I can do is I can go and return the error code. The similar error code can be consumed by my client, and whatever message is to be displayed on client view layer, they can go ahead and do it. But this would be a universal approach wherein returning the error code would be more handy, and same kind of error codes can be consumed by all the view layers and they can go and play with those error codes. Unless there is a reason, don't go for responsive web design because it comes with a penalty at performance layer. A lot of times when the development is done and the product is at production layer, and when there is some complaint about the performance of the site, the developers start digging that what can be done in order to improve the performance. So if for no reason if you have gone for a responsive web design, it is going to add a bottleneck at the performance, and unless there is a space requirement, we can probably avoid this right at the design time. So all decisions, whatever can be taken at design time, must be taken, and we must consider that performance tuning is not always a post-production job. Whenever a project is used, instead of adding all libraries with the project, especially for J2E projects, we can go and leverage Maven. And all version numbers must be explicitly mentioned for all the libraries and plugins that is being used. Instead of providing system.out and system.error, we must go and use SLF4J and logback for login. And as far as deployment is concerned in development environment, go for Jetty instead of Tomcat because that will give you the benefit of faster deployment, and at certain extent it will also provide you the benefit for hot deployment. As far as coding standards and practices are concerned for Spring and Maven development, the list is long, but probably in this forum we will not be able to address all of this. So if any of you are interested, you can write back to us at info@signet-infotech.com, and we will be more than happy providing you all the best practices and all the lessons that we have learned over the period of last 10 years for G2E development. With this, I will be ending with the theoretical concept on cross-platform development. I have with me my colleague Neil Mapaya, who is a technical lead at Signet Infotech and who is handling the G2E development for Signet. And he will walk you through the demonstration part for cross-platform application. Over to Neil.
Thanks, Neil. Hello, guys. I'm going to demonstrate how to implement Spring Mobile Framework and responsive web design. So let's first see about the Spring Mobile Framework example. So I already built Maven Spring project in Eclipse. Here is the project, Spring Mobile Demo. So first of all, we need to add jar file for Spring Mobile Framework. As I am using a Maven project, so I need to add dependency in pom.xml file. Let me open pom.xml, and I have already added Spring Mobile Framework dependency. The group is org springframework.mobile and architect ID is spring-mobile-device. And the version is I am going to use is 1.1.0.m2. And also you need to add one repository from where it will download Spring Mobile Framework jar. Repository is Spring Milestone. So it's all about pom.xml. We have added one dependency. Then we need to add repository. I'm going to use web MVC, so I also need to add dependency of Spring Web MVC. Now we need to add few things in discussercowlet.xml file as well. So let me open a discussercowlet.xml file. In discussercowlet.xml file, we have to add argument resolver. One is site reference web argument resolver, and second one is device web argument resolver. So by adding this value, you can get site preference and device object in controller method. Now we have to add few interceptors. So first is device resolver handle interceptor, and second is site preference handle interceptor. So by adding this interceptor, you can get current device and current site preference throughout the request processing. There is another interceptor I have added is site switcher handler interceptor. It is used for redirect users to dedicated mobile and tablet sites. You need to give constructors are value as /m for mobile, /t for tablet, and rest is for a web page. Now we need to add view resolver. So I have added view resolver. It's for JSP, so it's a standard view resolver that we have already used in Spring. The another thing is we need to add mobile prefix and stateless prefix. Both are used for determine the requesting from which device. Either it came from mobile or it came from tablet. Another property I said is enable fallback to true. So this property means if you set enable fallback to true, then it will first cater the request coming either from mobile or tablet. And in case of view resource cannot found, then it will attempt to resolve the original view request. So it's a useful feature of a property which is enable fallback. Now you can see the folder structure. I have added pages under web INF folder, and in pages folder I have added M folder, which is used for mobile, T folder, which is used for tablet, and I kept web pages under the pages folder. So under the M folder, it solves the mobile pages. Under the T folder, it solves the tablet pages. Now, I have created one controller. Controller which solves the simple JSP page. It solves the simple JSP page, and also I have added one request mapping annotation and one method having argument size preference, device and model. Using both the objects, type preference and device, you can identify the source from which device request has come, whether it came from tablet, mobile or web. Also, we can use few methods of type preference and device preference, devices, like is mobile, is normal or is tablet. If request came from web, then it set is normal as true. If request came from mobile, then it's true for is mobile method. And if request came from tablet, then it's true for tablet, is tablet method. Also, we log the site reference object and device to see the output in console. So let's this is all about the project section. So let's start application. For application, I am using Jetty server. I am using Maven, so I have added Jetty plugin in com.xml and set the goal as Jetty run and add the project. So let's run the server pop. So server is running. Now, once server is started, first we have to look the page in browser. So server is already started. So I'm going to open web browser and access the application. Our project is Stream Mobile Demo. Index those. Now you can see there is only available Stream Mobile Framework. whenever we think on three mobile network, the pain should be served from pages folder. Should be served from pages folder. So let me keep on the same mobile panel, please. So hello world, so the HTML request is served and the site response is normal and UI style is normal. So normal means it indicates its web request. So in the web request we have in JSP file, we use two objects, current type reference and current device. We get both the objects because of VSTAT interceptor in the string in the index.xml file. So by using interceptor we can get both the objects directly in the JSP file. And in console, you can see the site reference object, UI, and we also write two methods as UI.isNormal, UI.isMobile. So in console, UI.isNormal is written as a true because its request came from web page. Now, let's open same request on tablet. So I have tablet emulator in my PC. Now, so I'm going to access the same request in from mobile emulator. So whenever we access from send request from tablet, so pages should be served from slash t folder. Let's access the same request. So http slash colon one and two dot one and two dot page dot six four colon table user. Let me open the browser once again. So let me re-request the same HTTP colon. Dot eight dot 164 and 80804. Slash Spring Mobile demo slash index.jsp. So you can see the same output as we see in a web page. So when I click on Spring Mobile Framework, so pages should be stored from tablet folder. So Spring will automatically handle the situation. See, the site preference is tablet and device is also tablet. So pages is stored from the T folder. So Spring, we do not need to programming. Spring will automatically identify the request address, whether request is came from tablet, and it serves the page under the tablet folder. So now same way, I have changed my user address from browser to iPhone. So all about mobile. So when I'm going to access a browser, now I've set the default user agent as a mobile. So when I going to click on Spring Mobile Framework in browser, I am getting the pages from M folder, which is mobile folder. It's caching, so we need to delete the cache. One page. See this simple, very simple page. Just a page which is built on responsive web design. In responsive web design, we need to create or build a CSS like whenever request came from mobile or it came from tablet or it came from web, it should be automatically adjusted. So we need to build or design a page and add CSS which renders the UI according to request device. So let's run our request to responsive web design page. Now, here are the CSS for responsive web design. Now in the browser, I'm going to run responsive web design for web. When I click on responsive web design link, it loads the pages, simple HTML page. Now the same request I'm going to access from tablet. So when I access the same page from tablet, so responsive web design is a build such like both the response or response from for web and a tablet getting the same output. There is no problem with any kind of images rendering problem or any kind of position at all. It renders the page same like we see in web. So if we go for a mobile, then we can see the same page as we see in tablet and web. Okay, this is it from my side. Over to you, Neo. Hey guys, we are experiencing a bit of network delay, and probably you might have observed that there was a little delay in the screen that was rendering and the voice that we were delivering. So I apologize for the inconvenience, but the presentation and the source code for the demo application that we delivered would be available on our website. So you can go and make use of that in any of the application or the sample application that you might wanted to try. With this, we are done with the formal session for the cross-platform development, and we'll be happy answering any questions or concerns that you might have.